Okay, welcome as we begin Numasechet Taanit Daf Bet. Taanit is all about the fast days that were instituted whenever rain did not come on time, and then the rabbis instituted fast days of increasing severity as time went on, because if there's no rain, then nothing grows, and it could be really a dire situation. So we begin with the tefillot, which are actually very relevant. Me'matai mazkirin geburot geshamim. Let's clarify a couple of terminology. When we say mazkirin, to mention rain, that's talking about in the second beracha, when we say mashiv haruach u'morid hageshem. We'll see later where we talk about sho'alim, to request rain. That's in the ninth beracha, when we say v'ten tal u'matar libracha. So the question here is, Me'matai, the same opening word as in Masechet Berachot. So we like to open with this kind of question. When during the year do we begin to mention the strength of Geshamim? The Gemara will discuss why we call it strength of Geshamim. When do we start saying, switching from Morid Atal to Mashiv HaRuach or Morid HaGeshem? We'll see two opinions here. We're going to see a few more opinions in the Talmud. Rabbi Eliezer Omer Miyom Tov Harishon Shel Hag. Hag is always means the Sukkot. We just say the holiday, because Hag comes from like in Arabic, Hajj, means the pilgrimage. And most people came to the pilgrimage to Jerusalem on Sukkot. So that's what we call it. So from the first day of Sukkot, that's when you start saying Mashiv HaRuach Morid HaGeshem. Gemara will explain that, because that's when we start taking Lulav, right? And Lulav is also associated with praying for rain, hoping for good winds to come. So the first day, Rabbi Yoshua Omer Miyom Tov Acharon Shel Chag. Rabbi Yoshua says, no, wait till that last day on Shemini Aseret. That's when we start saying Mashiv HaRuach Morid HaGeshem. After all, we don't want it to rain during the holiday. We want to be able to sit in the Sukkah. So wait till the end. Okay, now we have a discussion. Amar Rabbi Yoshua, Hoyel Ve'en HaGeshemim Ela Siman Kelala BeChag. Lama Hu Maskir. Rabbi Yoshua says, why would you start mentioning rain on the first day of the holiday? After all, rain is a curse during the holiday. We saw that famous Midrash. It says if someone goes and sets his table and goes into the Sukkah and then it starts raining, you know what it's like? It's like if you're a servant pouring wine for your master and the master is angry at you and he takes the wine and pours and throws it into your face. That's the same. It's a negative. So we don't have water poured in our face. Hashem saying, get out of the Sukkah. I don't want you here. So why would you start praying for rain on the first day? Wait till the last day. Okay, Rabbi Yoshua makes sense. Amar lo Rabbi Eliezer, af ani lo amati lishol, ela lehazkir, mashiv haruach morid hageshem be'onato. Rabbi Eliezer says, I agree with you. I didn't say that we should start requesting rain in the ninth beracha and by saying, ten tal matal libracha. Rather, I'm only talking about the second beracha. The second beracha, the first three berachot, are only praise. I'm giving a general praise. Hashem, you are the one who brings wind and rain. You could say that anytime, really. And so I'm not actually requesting it. I'm just preparing the way, right? You know, Hashem, you're the one that brings the rain. Hopefully you bring it this year. So Rabbi Yoshua says back to him, if that's the case, then you should mention rain all year long, even in the summer, because you say, I'm not really requesting it. I'm only mentioning it. The Mishnah continues and says, En sho'alim et ha-geshamim ela samuch la-geshamim. Furthermore, when do we actually start asking for rain in the ninth beracha? We only do that when we get close to the time of the rainy season. We do that in the beginning of December. It actually follows a solar calendar, because that's when we really need the rain to come. So asking for requesting rain is a completely different story from mentioning. Back to the mentioning. The Biyuda Omer Ha'aveh Lifnei Teva B'Yom Tov Ha'acharon Shel Chag Ha'acharon Maskir Harishon Eno Maskir. When do we make the switch? We actually make the switch from Shacharit to Musaf. So whoever goes in front of the Teva, this is the way of referring to the Chazan, on the last day of Sukkot, meaning on Shemini Aseret, the second Chazan, the Chazan for Musaf, will say Mashiv HaRuach Morid HaGeshem. The first Chazan for Shacharit does not say it. And that's exactly what we do. Shacharit, we say Morid Atal. Only Musaf, we start Mashiv HaRuach Morid HaGeshem. ביום טוב ראשון של פסח, הראשון מזכיר, האחרון אינו מזכיר. However, when do we stop all the way on Pesach? Pesach is the first day of Pesach that the in Shacharit we say Mashi Baruch Amir Degeshem, and the second Chazan from Musaf stops and says, "That's it. We don't say it anymore." And that is the Mishnah. Okay, Gemara will discuss Tana Hecha Kae Dekatanim Ematai. The Gemara is going to ask a simple question: how do you start off the Masechet saying, "Oh, when do we mention Giburot Geshamim?" Where are you coming from that you're already sudden, or all of a sudden jumping right into the topic? Right, tell us first that we have to mention it at all. First, tell me you have to mention it. Then I can ask, okay, when do we start mentioning it? And the answer is Tana Hatam Kae, the Katani Mazkirin Giburot Geshamim B'tchiyat HaMetim. Here it is. It's actually a baraita in Masechet Berachot that says you should mention the strength of rain and the second beracha of Tichiyat HaMetim. By the way, why there? What does rain have to do with resurrection of the dead? Well, it has a lot to do with it. In a way, the rain coming, the new season, is a mini Tichiyat HaMetim. During the winter, everything dies, and the trees are all barren, the fields are empty, and then you have when the rain comes and the spring comes, then things start growing again. So with the cycle of the seasons, you see everything die and then come back to life. And therefore, that is a one example of the power of Hashem, the power through rain to bring the dead back to life. And so that, therefore, it's appropriate right in the barakah, the same barakah we also say, Rofe Cholim, Somech Nofelim, Matir Asurim, anyone who's sick, in trouble, and Hashem helps them out. Those are all small examples of Tichiyat HaMetim. So it's really a very beautiful barakah. And the Braita continues and says, "V'shoalim beberkat hashanim," and then we actually request rain officially in the ninth beracha that ends mebarech hashanim. "V'havdala bechonen adat," and we add in havdala in the chonen adat because that beracha is all about knowledge, and you have to know how to distinguish between kodesh and chol, between day and night. And that's the appropriate beracha to mention that now Shabbat and Yom Tov is over. That's the beraita. Okay, good. So we already know from berachot that you have to mention it. But now next question. Right, and there you go. And based on that, that's why we say Geburot Geshamim, because that beraita already said that you have to say it. Now we ask why. Okay, but our question is Vilit Nihatam. Fine, that beraita was a very long time ago, all the way back in Seder Zeraim in Masechet Berachot. Why don't you ask the question back there? Why'd you wait till now? After we learned so much in between, why'd you wait till after Rosh Hashanah? Ela, rather a new answer. What this whole thing is doing here? Tana me Rosh Hashanah sadik detnan ubechag nidonin al hamayim. The second Mishnah in Masechet Rosh Hashanah said, the Sukkot talked about four times of the year in which the world is judged, and said on Sukkot, we are judged for regarding water. Well, now that you mentioned that we're judged regarding water, so after we finish the whole Masechet Rosh Hashanah, then we begin and talk elaborating on that point, being judged on the water. What if the water doesn't come? Right, we have to pray for it beforehand, hope for it to come, and what we do if it doesn't. So what you see here is that the order of the Masechtot were already known in the times of the Talmud. I don't know about all of them, but at least this one, right? But for sure, Taanit has to come after Rosh Hashanah. Since you already taught me in Masechet Rosh Hashanah that we are judged regarding the water, so now we ask, oh, when should we start mentioning? When's it appropriate to begin? Okay, very good. We also saw a hint to Taanit in the end of Masechet Rosh Hashanah, so they're all linked together. Now, next question is, what is this strange phrase that you said, call it the strength of rain? Why don't you just say, from when do we mention regarding the rain? What do you mean strength of rain? By the way, this type, notice that we didn't quote any names of Amoraim yet, right? Although actually we're about to. But this is typical of opening sugya. of in the Talmud Bavli. It's kind of introduction. It's more just about like word, just about words, like the style of the Mishnah before we get into the real content of it. So here, Amar Rabbi Yochanan, Mipnei Sheyordin Bigbura. The reason is because when rain comes down, it comes down with great strength. If you were around today in New York, you saw hail, like really, mamash, right? Ice hail coming down. It was dangerous to be outside. You really saw that strength. Okay, but we not only experience it, we also derive it from Pesukim Shenemar. Oseh gedolot ad en haker, v'niflaot ad en mispar, uchtiv hanoten matar al pene haaretz, v'sholech mayim al pene hosot. So we quote two Pesukim. It's not clear how these Pesukim prove that rain has strength. Not one word in any of this Pesukim has the word Gevura. It does say the word Gedolot, and this is referring to the things Hashem does in general are Gedolot, are so great beyond comprehension. Miracles without number. Okay, that sounds like a general thing that Hashem, the things that Hashem does. And that's a Pesuk in the Yov 9:10. And then another Pasuk in the Yov chapter 5, so that I'm connected to each other, that I'm near each other, says, Hashem, you bring dew on the land, and you send water all upon the fields. So this does talk about rain, but it doesn't talk about Givura, and it's not connected to the previous Pasuk. So it's really unclear what's going on here. To solve this problem, we have to we can notice that there's this Pasuk in the Yov comes up twice almost the same way. So in the Talmud, it quotes the version in Iyov chapter 9, Ose Gedolot Ad En Haiker. But in Iyov chapter Hey, it says, Ose Gedolot Ve En Haiker, Niflot Ad Emispar. And that's the Pasuk right before the one that it quotes next, Hanoten Matal Pene Haaretz, Al Pene Haaretz. So you see, it's clear that the Gemara meant to quote Iyov Hey, Tet, and Yud. For whatever reason, I don't know if this was because they memorized it or some scribe remembered this version, Ad en Chaked, and put that in, but it's appropriate to change it to Ve en Chaked, and it's the Pesukim are back to back. Okay, so now we're much closer to an explanation. We see that rain is associated with Gedolot and Niflaot, which are synonymous with Givura. Okay, we still didn't fully explain it because we don't have the word Givura here. So that's what the Gemara will say next. My mashma, what exactly did you mean? Where's the Givura? Amad Abba bar Shela atya cheker cheker mebriyato shel olam. We're going to use a gezerah shava from the word cheker, aden cheker here. That's in this pasuk, the first one that it quotes. And it appears also in another place. Let's see. Ketivacha ose gedot aden cheker. Uchtivatam halo yadata im lo shamata. Elohe olam Adonai bore kesot ha'aretz lo yi'af lo yiga en cheker litbunato. So here's another word that says it's unfathomable, en cheker. And here it's talking about the creation, the Hashem's creation, the creator of the ends of the earth is amazing. And then that's pasuk in Yeshaya. And there's another pasuk in Tehillim says, Mechin harim bekocho nezar bigvura. He who makes mountains is girded with strength. So now we can get the whole connection. There's a pasuk regarding making mountains, creation. And there it says the word givura. So therefore, anytime we talk about Hashem's creation, that is also givura. And that pasuk has en cheker. And so then we go back and we see there's a pasuk in the Yov. Well, this one that says en cheker, and the pasuk right after that talks about rain, and so you connect all the dots, and now you get givurot of givurot geshamim. Okay, good. In a way, you could make it even just think of it more directly that bringing rain is an act of creation. It's creating the plants; everything grows. You know, the creation isn't just a one-time event at the beginning of time, but rather an ongoing event that we witness every day. Okay, beautiful. So now that we know that it's appropriate to mention Givurot Geshamim, the question is, how do you know that you should say it during the tefillah? Uminala de bitfila de tanya, lahava et Hashem elokechem ul obdo bechol lebabchem ezohi aboda שהיא בלב, הווה אומר, זו תפילה. וכתיב, בתרי ונתתי מיותר שכם בעתו, יורה ומלכוש. Because in the Shema says we should love Hashem our God and serve him with our hearts. How can you serve God with your heart? I can understand you serve God with your hands. You could go and do something with your legs. Go run and somewhere and perform something. But how do you serve God in your heart, in your mind? That is through tefillah, through praying, concentrating, thinking about the words. And within that paragraph, it says, and I will give you rain at the right time. So therefore, one of the things that we should mention every day is a prayer for rain. Not every at the appropriate seasons is a prayer for rain. And so that's how we know. Okay, good. So now that we got that introduction to the side, now we understand where we're coming from. Now let's see where we're going. Amar Rabbi Yochanan. שלושה מפתחות בידו של הקדוש ברוך הוא שלא נמסרו ביד שליח, ואלו הן מפתח של גשמים, מפתח של חיה, מפתח של תחיית המתים. Nice agada, Rabbi Yochanan, we saw already, says there are three keys that Hashem keeps and he does not give to an agent. Other things he gives to agents. You know, you take care, you're in charge of this portfolio, you're a secretary of something else, but the keys for rain and for someone giving birth, a woman giving birth, that she should be healthy, and for resurrection of the dead, these Hashem deals with directly. How do we know? Mafter shegeshamim tichtiv iftach Adonai lecha atosaro hato bet ha-shamayim latet metar secha be'ayto. Here it says Hashem directly should open up for you the treasure houses of rain. This may go back to a time when it was believed, the cosmology of the world is that there's storehouses of rain up in heaven, and there's little doors, right, that open up, and that's how the rain comes down. You could look at the description of the Mabul is like that. Mafteach shel hayah, the truth is actually really more amazing, right, that water goes up from the oceans and comes down and with the whole water cycle. Mafteach shel hayah minayin dechti vayizkor Elohim et Rachel vayishma eleha Elohim vayiftach et Rachma. Parashat HaShavua, perfect. We read this today, and Hashem remembered Rachel and opened her womb, and she became pregnant. And so you see, Hashem is involved directly in giving, allowing women to have safe births. Mafteach shetirat emetim minayin dechti vidatem, ki ani Adonai, v'fitchi et kibrotechem. This is from Yechezkel 37, the famous nevoah of the field of dry bones, and Yechezkel sees them rise up, and flesh is attached, and skin, and they come back alive, and he says this represents the nation of Israel that will go from death back to life, and then you will know that I am Hashem when I opened your graves. In other words, Hashem does it directly. Good. That's three. In the West, they say, it's curious this is in the West, because the first three were said by Rabbi Yochanan, who is in the West, but okay, for whatever reason, added to Rabbi Yochanan's tradition, some in the West say, Af mafteach shel parnasa. Not only those three, but also the keys for earning a livelihood. As it says, Hashem, open your hands and give everything, all life, what it needs to live. Question, Yochanan says only three. He didn't count this one. How come he didn't count the livelihood? It's the same thing. If you get rain, back then, 95% of the population were farmers. So if you have rain, then things will grow. Then you'll have panasa. So that does represent livelihood. And this is good today, because even though most of us aren't farmers, and we're not directly dependent on the rain, but nevertheless, when you think of rain, you can have in mind also all of our work and all of our livelihood, that it should be successful. Rabbi Eliezer Omer, Yom Tov HaRishon Shel Chag. Okay, now into the halachic content. Rabbi Eliezer says, we should start Mashiv HaRuach on the first day of Sukkot. Ibai Elohu, Rabbi Eliezer, Mecha Gemir La, Melulav Gamar La, O Minisuch HaMayim Gamar La. The question is, where did Rabbi Eliezer learn this from? Is he comparing Mashiv Morid HaGeshem to Lulav, which we take on the first day, and so too mention rain on the first day, or from the water libation that is begun on the first day, and so too we should mention Geshem on the first day, right? It's the truth is that on Sukkot, we do two other rituals that have to do with rain and starting the process of asking Hashem, thanking Hashem for rain and requesting for the future. So it could be compared to either one of these. So how could we tell which is the answer? And the answer is Midlulav Gamarla. Madlulav Bayom, Av Haskara Bayom. Odiyam Nisuchamayim Gamarla, Man Nisuchamayim Meurta. Well, it would seem that it's from lulav because lulav is only brought during the day. There's no mitzvah of lulav at night. So just like mitzvah lulav is brought during the day, when do we start mentioning morid hageshem? In the daytime, in the morning, it happens to be in musaf. So that would make sense. Or maybe we learn it from Nisuch HaMayim. And Nisuch HaMayim can be even from the night. Remember the word Me'urta, even though it sounds like Or, actually means the nighttime. As it says, Umin Chatam V'Niskehem, something about the plural of the multiple libations teaches us that you can bring it during the day, you can even bring it at night. This is curious, because actually we don't generally bring any libations at night. But the point is that from the letter of the law, even though a korban musaf has to be during the day, the animal itself, if you bring the wine libation at night, it's okay. And so too, the water libation, even though they always brought it during the day, technically they could have brought it at night. So maybe if we learn it, if we compare morid hageshem to the water libation, then maybe we should start saying mashib haruach from the nighttime, start from arbit on the first night of Sukkot. That's the question. Here's the answer. Tashema, Tamar Rabbi Abhu, lo limedah Rabbi Eliezer, ela milulav. In truth, he learned it from lulav. We're going to see a proof in a second. Ika damre Rabbi Abhu gemara gemidla, vika damre matnita shemi'ale. Has Rabbi Abhu know this? Some say that he learned it from a tradition. He has a tradition that this is it. It's an oral tradition. Others say he actually has a full-fledged baraita. That he was a braita that was taught that has this information. And according to the second one that he has a braita, we're going to quote the braita. By the way, here's a picture of a jug that is on a bar kochba coin. Bar kochba coins always put symbols of the Beit HaMikdash on their coins. So a jug here is the one that would be used for a nesech, probably for a wine libation, or could be water libation also. And when the water was poured on the mizbeach, was poured into a receptacle, and then it would go down, and this would go down into a hole in the mizbeach and go all the way down to the foundation. Okay, Maihi, what is this baraita that you refer to by which we can prove that Rabbi Eliezer compared saying morid hageshem to lulav? Look at that. The Braita, it's a parallel to our Mishnah, but it says it in a different way. Instead of saying the Bialya says you start on the first day, it says from the time that you first take the lulav. We first take the lulav on the first day of Sukkot. And Rabbi Yoshua says, no, you start saying morid hageshem after you put down the lulav. When do we put down the lulav for the last time? On the seventh day. So then after that, on the eighth day, that's when you start saying, Mashiv Aruach Umorid Hageshem. So it's always interesting to see parallels that Mishnah says it one way, the Baraita says it another way. How did Rabbi Eliezer and Rabbi Yoshua really say it? I don't know. We have multiple versions. Maybe they said it this way, and then the Biyud HaNasi just kind of summarized it in a simpler language, or maybe the other way around. I don't know. Okay, so we're lucky to have this baraita. Now we know their reason. Okay, now we're going to quote a longer baraita that's going to elaborate on all of these reasons. Amar Rabbi Eliezer, Ho'il v'arba'at minin halalu, enan ba'in ela l'rasot al hamayim, uchshen sh'arba minin halalu, yefshar bahem belo mayim, kach yefshar la'olam belo mayim. Rabbi Eliezer now explicates his reason. Since the four minim, lulav and trog, why do we bring them at all? We bring them to pray for rain. And also, they depend on rain. They wouldn't grow if you didn't have rain. Therefore, there's no. It's not possible for the world to exist without water. That's why when we bring the lulav, we should also say words and pray for rain. So that makes perfect sense. Amalu Rabbi Yoshua, Halo Geshamim Behageno Ela Siman Kelala. Rabbi Yoshua says, yeah, but praying for rain explicitly on the holiday is a curse. We don't want it to rain while we're trying to sit in the sukkah. You see, this braita is an expanded version of our Mishnah. I don't know if it's expanding or maybe this is the original. Probably more likely this is the original conversation. And the Mishnah is just giving us a little snippet of it because the Mishnah has to be very concise to be memorized. Although all these Baraitot were also memorized, but not by everybody. Okay, Amar lo Rabbi Eliezer, af ani lo amarti lishol, ela lehazkir. Rabbi Eliezer says, I agree with you. I'm not saying that we should pray for rain. We don't actually want it to rain on Sukkot. Rather, just mention it as a praise. We're starting to think about rain. Uchshem shetichyat ametim mazkir kol hashana kula, v'na ela bizmana, and Rabbi Eliezer continues with a really good proof. He says, we mention all year round, right? We say that baracha all the time, whether it's the time of Mashiach or not, whether it's the time of resurrection or not. We don't know what it's going to be. So too, it's appropriate to mention rain, even if it's not, even if we don't actually want it to rain right now. And according to that, Rabbi Eliezer says, if you feel like mentioning rain all year round, go for it. If you just like really love and are inspired by rain and you want to say, Mashi Baruch Mirid Hageshem all year round, it's okay, you could do it. Okay, now we're going to see a few more opinions. We only saw two so far, the first day and the last day. Now we're going to see more. Rabbi, that's Yehuda HaNasih, Omer Ani, he says, whenever you stop asking for rain, meaning when we go from Barech Alenu to Barechenu, when we stop saying 10 Talmatan Libracha and the ninth Barecha, that's also the same time that we stop mentioning Mashiach Baruch Medegeshem. In other words, don't say it all year round. You got to stop. And they go together. Rabbi Yehuda ben Betera Omer, different Rabbi Yehuda than Rabbi Yehuda HaNasih. You should start saying Mashiach Baruch HaGeshem not on the first day, not on the last day, on the second day of Sukkot. He'll explain why. Rabbi Akiva omer Bashishi Bechag HaMaskir, on the sixth day of Sukkot. So now we have the first day, second day, sixth day, or eighth day. Four different opinions. Rabbi Yehuda Mishum Rabbi Yoshua omer Ha'obel Lifnei Teba B'Yom Tov Acharon Shel Chag Acharon Maskir HaYishon Eno Maskir. Okay, Rabbi Yehuda, in the name of Rabbi Yoshua, he's explaining Rabbi Yoshua. When Rabbi Yoshua says this on the last day, it's not for Shacharit of the last day, but rather only for Musaf of the last day. So therefore, the second Chazan says Morid Hageshem, the first Chazan, Shacharit, does not. V'yom Tov Rishon Shel Pesach, Rishon Maskir, V'acharon Eno Maskir. Whereas on Sukkot, when you stop saying it, the first Chazan says Morid Hageshem, and one for Musaf says stops saying it. Okay, that's the end of the Braita, the expanded version of our Mishnah. Now, Gemara, we'll discuss it a bit. Shapir kama le Rabbi Eliezer, Rabbi Yoshua. Doesn't Rabbi Eliezer have a really good point that you say Tichyat Emetim all year round, even though you don't want to know when it's going to be? So too, yeah, maybe it's okay to say Mashi Baruch all year round. Isn't that a good point? You could see the style of how they learned in the Bet Midrash during Amoraic times. They would take these Tanaim and say, you know, what do you think about that? How would you answer for that Tana? Right? And then he would have to go back and they would recreate the debate. So Amalecha Rabbi Yoshua, well, Rabbi Yoshua could answer you and say, Bishlamat Techiyat Metim Maskir, Tekule Yom Azim Nehu. Truth is that Techiyat Metim can be any time. We don't know when it's going to be. It's not limited. But for rain, any time it rains, is it good? It's not. We're going to see in the Mishnah later on in this Masechet that once Nisan is completed and it rains in the middle of the spring or summer, that is bad. We don't want it to rain because by that time we cut the grain in the fields, and now we leave it out to dry. And now, if it rains on top of the grain that's drying, it will cause it to rot. So it's terrible if it rains at that point, right? So it's not like, yeah, rain's good anytime. No, we got to stop praying. Unlike Tichat Emetim is good anytime. We'd love to see our great grandparents. Okay, pasuk in Shemuel, which says, "Is not the wheat harvest today?" And let me see. If we'll send thunder and rain, so you'll know that their wickedness is great. In other words, you see that this is a punishment to have rain after the harvest. Now, now let's go to the other opinions mentioned in this Beraita, the one who said this, you start saying it the second day of Sukkot. Why? Rabbi Yehuda ben Betera omer, Basheni b'chag u'maskir. My time at Rabbi Yehuda ben Betera, why would he say you start on the second day? Tanya, Rabbi Yehuda ben Betera omer, Ne'emar basheni v'niskehem, Ne'emar bashishi unsacheha, Ne'emar bashibi'i, Kemishpatam. Okay, this is the famous Mem Yud Mem. Hare Mem Yud Mem Hare Kan Mayim. All right, let me show you the Pesukim inside so we can appreciate this. If you look at the Korbanot, the Musaf offerings on Sukkot in Bemidbar in Parashat Pinchas, you see that for each day, the last word is you bring all the Chatat and the Tamid and everything, Viniska, and the wine libation. For it, it's wine libation. Good. And that is true for most of the days. The first, third, three, four, five are all the same. But on the second day, it says v'niskehem in plural. It's unusual. Why has it come out of its way? And all of a sudden, this one's in plural on the second day. Their libations. The other one that's out of ordinary is on the sixth day. It says, and its libations. So that's an extra yud. More than the usual viniska, the first one has an extra mem, more than the usual viniska. And then on the last day, it says also viniskehem in plural. So if you just take off the extra letters, the mem here, the yud here, and the mem here, it put it together, you get mem yud mem mayim. Okay, this is a very unusual kind of drasha. I can't think of any other example like this. But what you do see is that it says this extra mem on the second day. So the truth is you have to explain this somehow. Every Baal Koreh knows, oh yeah, I have to remember this one, right, is different ending. Don't just read it the same. So if you could think of a better explanation, let me know. Since it says the extra mem on the second day, that's a hint that we should bring the water on the second day. We should start, therefore, mentioning water, Morid Geshem, on the second day of Sukkot. So that's his derasha. Okay. Umay shena basheni denakat, dechidem izeh dehu bikra basheni hu derem izeh, delkach basheni medkirinan. Since the Torah went out of its way to hint to it, it does call it a demiz, right? So this is not really a full-fledged derasha. It's just a hint so that you can remember it. You have to also remember that the Nisuch HaMayim was a subject of a huge controversy because the Sadokim said, Stano Torah, we shouldn't do it, right? Remember the Sadoki Kohen Gadol that poured it on his feet and he got pelted with Etzrogim? So therefore, to bolster their position, the rabbi said, it's not, we don't only know from oral tradition, there's even a hint to it in the Pesukim themselves, right? How would you explain this, Mem Yud Mem? So we do have an extra hint. Since it's hinted to on the second day, this is the first mem, therefore we mention Shibaruach on the second day. All right, and now we get to finally to be Akiva Omer Bashishi Bechag Umaskir. Nema Bashishi Unsacheha Bishne Nisuchin HaKatum Medaber Echad Nisuch HaMayim Echad Nisuch HaYayin. Rabbi Akiva learns it a little bit more simply. On the sixth day, it says Unsacheha, and it's libations. So this is a really unusual word. The truth is, when it says v'niskehem, their libations, that is actually, that you can explain that just fine. There are many korbanot, and each korban has its own wine libation. Therefore, there are many libations for many korbanot. So that's v'niskehem. But the word unsacheha is unsachim shela, its libations. It's talking about one korban that has many libations. There's no such thing as one korban has many libations. Therefore, it's hinting to something added. Besides the wine libation, there must be another one that's completely different, and that's the water. So therefore, you see, according to Rabbi Akiva, the v'niskehem has nothing to do with the wine libation, only the one, this one, unsacheha, and that's one on the sixth day. Therefore, we only start bringing the Nisuch HaMayim on the sixth day, and therefore, see, he's connecting the mention of Mashiach Baruch Medageshem to Nisuch HaMayim. Unlike what we said before for the Rabbi Eliezer, he connects the Mashiach Baruch Medageshem to Lulav, which everyone agrees is brought on the first day. So there you go, Rabbi Akiva has a very nice derasha. Echad Nisuch HaMayim, Echad Nisuch HaYayin. Now, Ema Talvayhu De Hamra, How do you know that both of them are not for wine? For that, we'll go back to the Rabbi Yehuda ben Betera that said, the hint, mem yud mem. Okay, so because you say something else, maybe it means another libation of wine, maybe a libation of some other liquid. How do you know it's water? So even Rabbi Akiva can be helped by Rabbi Yehuda ben Betera, who did say the mem yud mem, and therefore we have another hint that it is in fact water. Hold on, if he accepts that, the mem yud mem, though he should say the second day, since the mem, the first mem is on the second day. No, the extra word, the extra letter is only on the sixth day. It says un sacheha, right? That's his main derivation. And the other thing, the mem that comes from before, is just letting you know that what should you bring? What else should you pour? It is water. But the main thing, that the fact that it says you should pour something else, an extra thing, that's on the sixth day. And therefore, he would say Mashiach Baruch Mele Geshem only on the sixth day. And this last point, this reminds me of Rabbi Akiva. He's the one that Moshe Rabbeinu is in the back of the classroom. Hashem says there's going to be a sage in the future who's going to learn mounds of halachot even from a single little stroke. And this is a good example from the yud, the tiniest letter, right? Just one little drop of ink. He learns that this entire mitzvah. Baruch Adonai Leolam. Amen ve'amen.